discussion about the impacts of design decision on software usage and adoption. So I think that's going to be a way to, let's say, follow up a bit the talk that Ginger did this morning. I was there for I wasn't there for all the talk because I had to eat and to finish preparing my presentation, but I was there a long time during the discussion, and I think we're gonna be able to speak about that. So that should be good. This is it. So for those who weren't there yesterday, I'm Educational Services Director at Revolution Linux. I was a high school science teacher before. I did some coding a bit in PHP, did some tutorials, did some translations, was in communities, did some part of manual, did write a textbook, and did a lot of things using free software and promoting free software. So the thing I'm going to present you today is really something to start off a discussion. So I would like it not to take 30 minutes, but really to have a good 10 minutes of discussions together. And I'm sure that the presentation of Peter afterwards for new UI design on GIMP will help generate more discussion again. So why this presentation? First, I'm going to give you my point of view as mainly a user, if you wish, but also somebody that is always in interaction with technical people at the office. That's my role at Revolution Linux, and teachers and users and IT administrator that sometimes go a bit frenzy when we're talking about open source and the interfaces and the usage of the software that you're in and that you're developing. So my goal is really to create discussion, but more than that, I do this because I think that free and open source software can be used everywhere. And I hope I did write it small enough that maybe sometime the decisions we take when we program software can prevent this from happening. So you're going to see I'm going to maybe punch one or two things on some slides. I saw John Phillips tweeting some things earlier saying I said some serious things earlier, so I hope that I'm not going to be too serious in my talk. So I do this mainly because of that, because I'm in contact with people in primary schools and secondary schools, and those people there are the people which will be your colleagues, which are mainly, which may be developers, because there are some of those guys and girls out there that develop free software. So those are the people who are using the software that you're making. Those are the people who are going to be the next graphic designers of all time. So this morning we saw people that were 20 years old, a person that were 30 years old and that were already using Adobe Photoshop. When we're talking about those guys there, they never saw anything before. So we had the chance to modify how they could interact with software and how they could have those generic skills that we talked earlier this morning that are so important, because and if you go into the programs of Quebec, Ontario, and Canada, and the US also, almost everywhere it's those IT generic skills are there. So nobody is forced to teach Microsoft Word. It's just a matter of the software. But sometimes, and that's why I'm going there in my presentation, sometimes our ways of reacting to the users that are coming and our ways of changing our software that we love so much prevent users from using it. So first, there was nothing. And then all your software appeared. All the software, the free software appeared. So why did I put those two slides? Because a lot of people seem to just magically appear in the free software world. Like if they never used software before. But you know what? Software and people have a past. People and software have ghosts. There's something that are hidden in the past of all your projects of GIMP, of Scribus, of Inkscape. Things, wars that happen, joyful events, all those kind of things that newcomers don't know, and that that will prevent people from using the software just because we had a fight about that like 5 years ago, so you're a jerk just by asking that kind of question, or that by suggesting that we could change the UI that way so that people could, well, you're not supposed to think about that because, you know what, we had a fight when I was reading the Progressive Farmer magazine on my rocking chair with my laptop. And we had a fight about that 20 years ago. But new people that are coming in, the software usage, like the teacher I showed before and the primary school, students and secondary students, they don't know about that. They just want to use the software and be able to maximize what they can do with it. Now, projects also have a future. So we don't want to get stuck up in past decision and way of like preventing getting forward, because we know that we want to go somewhere. Like Zhao showed the new features coming in GIMP. We want our software to get better and to get used by more people. But a lot of times, this morning we were talking, I don't know the names of everybody, but somebody was saying that if we do good software, it's gonna get used by people. People are gonna just jump in the bandwagon and use that kind of software. So we don't have necessarily to have shackles that prevent us of going forward, but we have also to know that we're doing this in a way to have users, and that was the main kind of message that Ginger told us this morning. We have users that are using our software. Now this is weird because in the free software world, you all know that you try to scratch your own itch, and the implication of people in free software is mainly because it was fun for them and it helped them to do something before helping the others. The users seems to be just a consequence of scratching my own itch if I did something in a free software. Software becomes bigger than their developers, and sometimes people, I could say developers, but also promoters of the software that are never developers, that are not always developers if you wish, forget that those kind of users exist. So we rarely have brand new users, like a user that never touched a vector drawing software. It happens, but it's probably people that are like 7 or 8 years old, or maybe 10 or 15. They did touch those kind of things in a way somewhere, but we don't have any fresh users that never touched a thing. And people will react to the software and the decisions that we made in that way. We have new to that kind of software users, but it's not the same as brand new users. So when we were talking about people using Photoshop, CS, whatever, well, these are new users to GIMP, for example, but they're not new users. They have some habits, they have some bad habits that prevent them for just being open. The thing is, what can we do to help those people get in the open source software? My point in that presentation is that sometimes the decisions that we're making will prevent those people from getting in, and we could have done just simpler. Now this is difficult to handle because we have to apprehend what people are going to think, and we maybe didn't never use a Photoshop CS3, for example, or whatever software, and we don't know what the future of those software will be. So the idea is not just fighting for having those people changing software, but to know what are the real needs behind the fact that they're looking for a window placed there or there. So that's for the war, if you wish, between the people that were trying to bring from other software. Now, there are some people that were forgetting a lot, I think, and particularly in the kind of changes that were made recently in various software. I'm going to give you an example after that, but power users are often really close to developers. They will ask questions, they will get into technical issues, and they will suggest things. They will suggest ways of modifying those kind of things, and sometimes they will just jump on the GIMP list and insult everybody because they want the same kind of feature as in Photoshop, but those kind of users are able to use the software. A lot of people I meet are not power users. They're just like actual normal users. I go in schools where they're using GIMP, they're using Inkscape, and they just use it. They use it for simple tasks, but they use the software. And when we arrive with some changes, well, those people are kind of lost. They did choose to use the software, and because we did decide that the future was somewhere, well, they now have a complete change. For example, I'm going to stay positive at first, and I'm going to start trolling afterwards. This is a nice positive decision I found in Inkscape. It was a couple of years ago, but when magically one time I opened Inkscape, and the teacher that I was with opened that and saw the color bar at the bottom, well, that's great. You just click and you start, it changes the color, and now it goes. But that's obvious. You just had to go there or activate that kind of plugin, but that's the kind of design decision that is really simple, that is on top of everything, that may not change the core way of handling the SVG file format, but that will help more people using the software just because of that tiny little decision. If we go on the trolling side, well, we could say just the new GIMP UI. So I know that a lot of things have been said about that, but the saddest thing I heard from people was not that people didn't want to go to Photoshop, from Photoshop to GIMP, because, like, let them say stay with Photoshop, let's say. But the saddest thing I heard is people that are using GIMP for 2, 3, or 4 years and that cannot find their way around anymore. And they're just like, I liked the old GIMP. That's funny because those people are using free software, they're using their things, but they're kind of lost. And there's, shouldn't, do I have a way to put the things back like they were before? So why is that? And we have the same thing if you're a KDE user or if you use Amarok. There's a lot of trolls around that saying that, where are my old features gone? And I'm not talking about people not using software, I'm talking about actual, real, open source users that are kind of lost because they're trying to find their way. Where are we going with that? So I'm gonna give my slides afterwards, so they're gonna be on the website, and I'm gonna micro blog about that on Identica, so you could get that that blog post that I found a couple of weeks ago, the kind of innovation that gets it right. And the guy is is the wine maintainer for Ubuntu, and he said one thing that I found right. That's the first one. The other ones are mine. But ripping bandages can be a good idea if you have no users. So I like that. It's kind of provocative. I like doing provocative things like that. So if you have no users, it's easy to say just, well, we're gonna tear that thing out. So there. Now you lost a few hair, but it's okay. You're brand new now. You can change everything. So that kind of thing is never a good idea if you have some users. And I know that people try to do things to prevent that, but that is a point that is a problem. Changing user habit is hard. That's change management, really. It's really hard to change people that get used to things, and I'm not even talking about free software, I'm just talking about moving from a version of a software to another version. So it's really hard to do that, and the other thing is scared people often don't come back. So those kind of things is, when you try to convince somebody to use open source software, and they get scared because whatever, you open the terminal, for example. I try not to open the terminal in front of people because people get scared. They say, "Well, will I have to open the terminal myself?" And you can say all the things you want about the liberty of things and the possibility of scripting and everything. They don't care. Will I have to do a command line? So sure, it's gonna be fun when you're gonna be into it, and you won't run away when you're gonna open that window afterwards. But those kind of things are preventing users from adopting free software because of some decisions that we've made. I can see some example of that when there's some fatal error messages or kernel panic. So that's not the kind of messages, that's useful messages, but that's kind of scary messages. So it doesn't help user getting on the bandwagon, if you wish. Now, how do we do that? How can we help everybody putting some oil in everything so that it runs easier? So my first thought on that, and that's the thought I'm just throwing so that we can have a discussion on that. So I hope I said a couple of provocative things, but I really want everybody to to do a step forward and talk about that. So what I think about that would be, I'm sure there are always ways to ease the pain. So sometimes we have to make hard decisions and we have to change things. So how could we, I don't know, ease the pain? For example, I know that a lot of software tried to stay in alpha stage or beta. That was the KDE case for KDE 4, and at what time they said, well, we have to go with like KDE 4.0. And they're mad at the distributions for taking KDE in the distribution when it's not supposed to be ready. But I don't know, I throw anything in the air like that. Could they just have been stayed with the 3.99 version? I don't know, just not renaming the version as officially 4? Because just in the public eye, saying that something is a new number is a statement. It's saying, well, it's a new version, so you can use it. Well, it's a new version, but if you read all the 14 paragraphs under the release note, it says that it's not ready for production. Well, why did you change the number in the first place then? So I'm sure there's some way of communicating well to ease the pain, to make the people say, well, this is going to change, and I'm going to help you to apprehend the change. The helping the migration by migration script, by automated migration, by a way, for example, to in the preferences to go back to maybe some of the old features or some of the old ways of showing things, could be a way to prevent that users go away or stop using your software because it was good before and it's not good afterwards. So and I think the two last points are the best way to do that is to get people that think out of the box. So outside people of the project, users, people that you don't really know, that could be your relatives or whatever, that you just sit in front of the software and say, well, try to do that for me. And just look with a fresh eye on what the person does. You're going to see that the person's going to do some things that you would never have done. And I've seen that a lot of times when you get used in Linux, you know all the way around and you know the commands and everything. But if you put a user, just say, install that software, they're going to do things that you're not used to just because you've been there for so long. So you always take that door. But nobody noticed that we could maybe go out that door. Or if you put somebody that doesn't know the place here, he's going to try to go out that door too. Nothing prevents them to do so. So doing that and staying open, I think, are the main ways of getting more people on the bandwagon. So questions, but most of that discussions, if we can have some other inputs or challenges or other way of thinking about that. Yep.
With the mic.
So I'm actually curious. So SVG as a format is undergoing a big change right now because we're looking at how it's going to be put into HTML, text HTML rather than XHTML. And there's all sorts of error recovery behavior that might go along with that. And my question to you, and this is a genuine question we can talk about more later, but we're thinking of adding, this is a point at which SVG is probably going to change, maybe even dramatically. And we're wondering, is that a bad idea? Are we going to, I think we're at a point right now where SVG has not really taken off. SVG is successful, but it is not a huge success. Are we still at a point where we have 12 users so we can't change it? And so I'm interested in feedback about that from everyone.
I'd say that just personal feedback is no, you don't have only 12 users.
No, sorry, that's a reference to.
Yeah.
It's a reference to it. Earlier, to make, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. So the guy who made Make many years ago said, woke up one morning and realized, oh, Make is totally broken. I've got to change it this way. And he realized he couldn't because he had,
Users.
12 users.
Yeah. Yeah. But in a sense, I think that the hard part with those kind of software and file formats and everything is that you don't know how many people use it. And from being in schools and seeing what's going on, let's say in the world of people not that are not specialists, I'd say that SVG is quite used now. So my point of view on that is that the question that I'm gonna have when I'm gonna walk in schools is, are my old files that I did, are they still going to be working again? Will I have to go through a massive conversion, whatever, or those kind of things? And these are the user preoccupation. At the same time, well, we have to move, like I said, we have to go for the future also, so. The world is that.
Well, two things. First thing is, I wouldn't be too worried about the SVG situation because, for one thing, there's a really good spec. Well, there's a really well-defined spec. Hopefully. Maybe it's only my outsider view that sees it like that. Maybe it's more of a pipe dream, I think. Whereas, for example, if you go back to Word files, when we have to jump around between all the different kinds of versions, I don't think that's going to happen with SVG. And hopefully the new spec can do all of what the old spec would do, so conversion would be mostly painless. That was my first time. And the second one is, I really like the idea of the band-aid ribbon, because there's two solutions. Either at one point you're going to have users, right? You have to deal with it. So either you rip it slowly, and it hurts a bit, but it's a long time process. Or you rip it in one shot, and people, it hurts a lot, but eventually you get better faster, right? And that happens. You see it both ways, like UI changes going gradually, and then like same thing with KDE4. KDE4 is then ripping the band-aid really fast and hoping that everything goes well. So which of the two is better? I don't know, but I guess we'll see eventually.
Yeah, that's it. The problem I see is that when you do that, the person that pulls the bandage is often the developer, and the problem is people are not aware of what's under it.
Yeah, but they eat their own dog food. I mean, I'm pretty sure KDE people uses KDE. I mean, they're probably not developing KDE using GNOME.
I know that, but you see, I'm gonna speak for a personal point of view on that, but I cannot conceive that I open KDE and that I have a clock, just the clock in KDE on the bottom right, and that before I could go in the clock, and if I'm in Montreal or in Paris, I could right click and change the time zone, and I couldn't do that anymore in KDE 4. So that's why I said they're ripping the band-aid off, but you don't know what's under necessarily, so you may rip it more slowly, so just to be sure that it's not bleeding under. For those kind of little issues, that seems simple, but when you build, you took a lot of time to build all the components of the software, and it's a nice big construction, and you're just tearing the base off and starting off from new. You're gonna forget things for sure. So,
but at some point, you don't have an option. Like, you wouldn't be able to say, "Oh, let's implement a new spec of SVG halfway." I mean, that doesn't work. You can't do that.
Yeah.
So for some things, you've got to just pull it and pray for the best.
That's it. And the thing is, how could you help people if it goes a bit wrong or anything? That's more the point, and not receiving people saying, "Well, you're against change."
I guess in that case, not only have a good transition period, but have a good testing period. Like, the reason people bitched about KDE4 is because they were pressed to release a 4.0 version that wasn't ready at all. So, I mean, if they had told people not to use that and just being a testing version, I mean, I don't think there would have been as many outcries.
Other question, insults?
Kevin, I was wondering, in terms of the UI, would it be possible to make everything so customizable that you can tell people, well, if you don't like it, change it. Make it however you want it.
Yeah, but people don't do it.
That's a problem.
One problem with that is there are kills tutorials. You don't have a unified interface. Someone can't go on and just find out how to do these things because everybody's going to fork and somebody's going to use this particular UI. So,
yeah, that's part one.
True. So then you would need to have a standard configuration of UI for the tutorial to use this one. I don't know, maybe people could public their own versions of UI that would be optimized.
So it's typical on that topic. It's typical if you're an AutoCAD user. You're standard AutoCAD, and yet if you're a power user, depending on what you're doing, you're going to create your own shortcut. And so if you're teaching an AutoCAD course, you're going to teach the official version of AutoCAD. But if somebody becomes, you know, once you start using it, if you're always doing gears, then your shortcuts are going to be like stuff, right? If you're always doing architectural, your shortcuts are going to be architectural type stuff. And so you've got two people using the same hotkeys for quite different purposes, but that's not what you teach in your tutorial, right? The tutorial always does the official version, and then people can customize to whatever. So if somebody wanted to customize back to the old version, maybe just give them a quick recipe how to do it.
Yeah, the problem is sometimes it's not possible. So you could try to customize it to the old version, but you cannot come back because it changed. It's not working that way anymore. So that was one of my points in the presentations. When we do that, sometimes we have to rip the bandage off, but we have to be careful, because we don't know how many people really use that way of using the software.
This is on the topic of customization. I used to use KDE, and now I use GNOME. And the main reason is that I could customize a lot with KDE, but my viewpoint maybe is a bit black and white, is that one shouldn't expect the user to customize to make the product better. The only customization should be there to personalize. If the user interface is not good enough, that it's good enough as is, it's probably not good enough. This being said, I do nothing in the business of designing UIs. So. Your problem. Still on the customization topic, one thing we found out in Blender is that even if you allow all kinds of customization, which we mostly do and don't, but most people don't, even if you could make people, allow people to change anything, a majority of the user won't do it. Unless your default is really, really crap, they're going to use it, right? And even if it's crap, some people are still going to use it. So customization is good, but just make sure you have really, really good defaults, because everyone's going to use them. And the same thing happens with your question, like you're going to say, if we could bring back the old UI, but then once stuff in the background changes, you're going to have an old UI button that's not going to do the same thing. And that's a problem that GameShop had. Like, they were trying to reproduce the Photoshop UI, but all the functions were doing just slightly different thing that even if the UI was the same, it wasn't the same product. So, I mean, even if it was the same, the like you could put the Ford engine in a Ferrari, but it's still not a Ferrari.
Stop doing those kind of comparison, because I always wonder what's the Ferrari in our comparison. And I don't want it to be the other one.
Sorry.
So thanks for your attention.